Good morning, believers. So good to be in the house of God. We're going to start off with a song about joy. It says, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Does anybody believe that today? He's your strength. When sorrows come your way, he's going to be that shield that's going to surround you. Amen. Why don't somebody just shout out joy? Joy. Come on, put your hands together. We love you, Lord. We worship you, God. We lift our hands today. You're our Father. We love you. We love you. Put your hands together. Sing, though the tears may fall, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. Sing in the dead of night. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. joy, Lord. You are our hope today. I believe that. I believe that. In a congregation this size, I know today there's somebody that needs something from the King of Kings. Can you just lift your hands if that's you? And it should be all of us, really, because we need him every day, every hour. We need peace. We need grace and mercy. And he is here today. He is here today, whatever you need. Why don't you just let him hold you and love on you today?
Jesus, we just invite you into this place, God. Lord, we swing the doors wide open today and we say, come in, God. Come in and change the atmosphere today, Jesus. Come in and change our hearts today, God. Lord, break away any stony pieces of our hearts, God, so we can be sensitive to hear what you have to say to us today, Jesus. God, we open the doors today. We stand here wide open, God, in surrender to you today, Jesus. God, come in and fill us up today. We honor you, God, with our worship today, Jesus. We just exalt you, God. Do what you want to do in this place and have your way, Jesus. Have your way, God. We just want you today, Jesus. Is that right today, church? We just want him. Yes, God, we invite you here. Come on, somebody help me out and say, Jesus, God, the doors are open in my heart and in my spirit today, God. Lord, change me today, God. If there's no one else here that needs to be changed, God, change me. God, come into this place in a powerful way today. Yes, Jesus. God, we invite you here. Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you today, God. When you walk into the room, everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. And when you walk into the room, every heart starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you. Oh, we worship you. Sing it out today. that your prayer today. We just want you, Jesus. Today, hear the cry of your people, Lord. We are crying out to you today, Jesus, to fill us with your love, God. Fill us with your grace and your mercy till we're overflowing, that it can pour out of us and onto this land and this city and this state, God. Let nations be touched today, Lord. Let your kingdom be done on earth as it is in heaven. If you are thirsty, if you are hungry for a deep move of Jesus, can you just say, we want more? I want more. I need more. We need more. Shake us today, God. Shake us today, Jesus.
Show up.
sing, strip away our pride, strip away my pride and selfishness. Taken back and falling on my knees. Now I confess to you that you will always be enough. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, take us. Come and overtake us, Lord.
God, we believe.
Holy Spirit, lead us.
Breathe.
ask him to come and burn. Just wait on him right now. If you don't know what to do, just speak the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, there's going to be healings in this place today. Lives are going to be changed today. His glory is going to fall today, mighty in this house. We declare it. We speak peace over your lives today. Come and burn in me, Lord. Come and burn in me, Lord. Do you want to be filled with the fire and the passion today? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Speak over this house. Just begin to worship.
Some people, they'll say, well, God, the fire isn't going to fall on me. My altar's been cold for a long time. I've been stagnant. I've been in sin, this and that. But, you know, God proved with Elijah, it doesn't matter the condition of your altar. Your altar can be beaten. It can be have water doused all over it. But if you are hungry for the fire of God in your life, if you desire the presence and the power of God in your life, it's just a matter of saying, God, set a fire in me, Lord. Set a fire. My altar might not be right, God, but set it right, God. I can't wait until I put it in order, but God, set a fire in me. You put me in order today, God. Hallelujah. Let's lift our hands one more time. God, set a fire in us this morning, Lord. Set us ablaze, God. Let us be a light, Lord Jesus, in these times. Let us be the light of the hill, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Isn't he an awesome God this morning? Hallelujah. As we enter into the season of Thanksgiving, let's lift up a hand clap. God, you are great in this place this morning. We love you this morning, God. We praise you this morning, God. Hallelujah. God, we thank you that you are a good, good Father. We thank you for all that you've done for us. Amen. Hallelujah. We want to take this time this morning to welcome you to the Believer's Church. If you are a first-time guest or we haven't seen you in a long time, we are so glad that you've come out to visit with us this morning and to worship with us this morning. We wouldn't be here without you. Let's give any guests and first-time visitors a hand clap. Make them feel welcome. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being with us this morning. For those of you online or checking into the live stream, the presence of God is in this place. Hallelujah. We're going to about to transition, and in just a moment, you're going to see the kids go down as we do offering. The kids and the youth are going to be dismissed during the offering. But we want to take this time to worship Him in a different way, in giving and in thanksgiving, and bringing back to Him what is His. So as we enter into the season of offering and tithing, of course, you've got multiple ways to give. You can text through the 77977. You can give in the squares. You can give pushback. Or you can bring the ushers will be coming down to you. If you are a guest, feel free to leave your wallet in your purse, in your back pocket. This is not your time. If you feel led, that's fine. But this is for our members and our faithful members to sow into the kingdom of God. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege to give into your kingdom, God. We thank you for the privilege to bring back to you what is yours. We ask you to take it and multiply, God. Use it for the expansion of your kingdom, God. Use it for the glory of your kingdom, God. We give you all the honor. We give you all the praise today in your name. Amen.
Good morning. I hope you're doing well. I don't know if you can tell this by the sound of my voice
and my nose.
I feel a little bit under the weather. Don't worry, I'm not contagious. Anyway, my name is Jaron, and welcome to the Believers Church. If this is your first time, your second time, or you consider yourself to be a guest, I want you to check this out really quick. This is called a connection card, and we would love it if you filled it out. This is our way of getting to know you a little bit better. In addition to that, we'll send you something in the mail letting you know what your next step is here at Believers in order to get connected. Here in just a second, the message is going to be delivered, but before it is, I wanted to go over a few things. The first thing is Growth Track. This is a program that we are continually running here at Believers, and we only have one final lesson before it restarts. The reset date is going to be November 27th. So if you are new here and you want to get more involved, Growth Track is the first step. So if you've already filled out the connection card and you're looking for the next thing to do, after service, go to the lobby and sign up for Growth Track. It resets November 27th. Next is our altar workshop, and this is going to be on November the 30th, which is a Wednesday, at 7 p.m.
What's an altar workshop?
Well, that is why I am here, to tell you. At the end of every service, when we dismiss everybody, we also invite anybody that feels the need to come up and receive prayer. So for those of you that feel the need to assist in praying for people that have needs, we are creating this workshop.
Well, praying for people seems like a pretty simple thing.
This is where you would be incorrect. Praying for people is an art form. And if you get it wrong, altar call could look something like this. I'm just kidding. You don't have to worry about altar calls looking anything like that at our church. So if you want to make an impact in people's lives by being down front after service and praying for them, this is the event that you're going to want to come to. Finally, this is the big one. This is going to be huge. On December 18th, we are having our first ever ugly Christmas sweater extravaganza. Here's the deal. December 18th is a Sunday, but this is not going to be an ordinary service. It's going to be more like a party. The rule is, if you want to come, you have to wear the ugliest Christmas sweater you can find. I don't care if you make it yourself. There's going to be food, games, all sorts of stuff. Just to put a little bit of a competitive edge on this, we're actually going to have an ugly sweater contest. So bring your ugly sweater game. Anyway, that's it for me. Hopefully this has been an extremely informative experience. Thank you for your time and attention. Please enjoy the rest of the service. And yet again, welcome to Believers.
Awesome. Hello. Testing. 1, 2. Hello. There we go. We are live. Live in person. Here we go. Awesome. Always entertaining. Always a good time. And if you don't have our notes, you can follow along with us today. You can have these. They're passing these out right now. And if you don't have a pen or one of these, we want to get this to you. That way you can follow along with me as I teach this third lesson today. It is written. For those of you watching today live, we want to thank you guys for tuning in. We have a crowd who follows us online, and want to say thank you so much for tuning in today, whether you're watching on Facebook or you're watching this recorded. We just want to say thanks a lot for joining us. And actually, we have Amy. I believe Amy is watching live today, and that's awesome. And for those of you guys, maybe we have multiple Amys watching, but the Amy that I'm speaking of, She's a member of our church, and she had a blood clot in her brain and was paralyzed, essentially, from the mouth down. And the doctor said she would never recover, but she's at home watching today, and soon she'll be back in our church, and she's doing awesome. So, Amy, we love you. We're praying for you. And also, don't want to forget Adam. Thanks for playing with us today. We love you. Been like a brother to us for a very long time. Adam's been around. I've known him since I was a kid, probably 8 or 10 years old, it seems like. We've known each other for a very long time, and he's been playing with our band off and on for many years, and he is just a blessing to our church. So just want to say thanks to him. So today, if you've kept track, we are in part 3 of It Is Written. It's an awesome series, and today, if you look on the top of your notes, Part three, why the Bible can be trusted. How many of you guys know that the Bible is just, and just Christianity and our faith is just being attacked at all areas of our globe today? Christianity is being attacked, the Bible, the authority of the Bible, and the authority of the Word of God, and just the authority that God brings to our society is just being attacked. How many of you guys feel that? It just doesn't matter where you live in the world or where you're watching from right now. The authority of God's Word is being attacked all over the place, and we are here to stand up for the Word of God, and it is true and powerful in our lives, and we're here to say that God's Word and its authority, it will stand forever. Amen? Amen. So we're gonna jump right into this lesson today, and before I do, I always like to tell a story about my children. I always love to do that, right? It's always entertaining. They always entertaining if you have some kids, and you know how fun it can be. We have friends in here who always are posting videos or stuff about their kids, and it's always fun. So tomorrow is my son's fourth birthday, and can't believe that. It's hard to believe that he's already going to be 4 years old. And so this morning he comes into my room and he said, "There's one day until I'm four." And he was so excited. He was just, you know, just, if you know Jack, he already is just like this all the time. Like he just has caffeine just running through his veins. And I said, "Oh, Jack, I'm sorry, man, but we're going to have to make your birthday wait a week. You're going to have to wait a week to turn four. You can't turn four tomorrow because Daddy just can't have you being four already." And man, the look on his face, you should have seen the look on this guy's face. He just basically went, he was devastated. I told him he had to wait until a whole week until he was four, and he screamed and ran out of the room, and he was screaming, "Mommy, Mommy, Daddy's making me wait to turn four." And then I was leaving for church, and I told him, I said, "Gabe, I love you, buddy," you know, because Jack's doing his thing, and I said, "Gabe, I love you, buddy," and Gabe's my sweet one. And Gabe just, I went to give him a little kiss, and he just went and punched me right in the face, and I just walked out and left, and he was just, so, boys, if you ever get to watch this later in life, I love you very much. You're so sweet. Gabe, he's got a nice left hook, man. He's tough. And Jack, he's going to be four tomorrow, and that is crazy. It is really true that when I was a kid, my parents would always say, "Man, just life just goes so fast once you have kids," and that is just the truth. I promise, it really does speed up. It's really weird. I don't know how that happens, but it happens. Let's get into the Word of God. Why the Bible can be trusted, and we're going to read our first scripture today, and this is our tradition of our house, and we're going to go into Matthew 24, or actually, we're going to go into 2 Timothy. Sorry, just making sure you're paying attention. We're going to go into 2 Timothy 3:16-17. And if you know me, I like to have a little bit of fun while we're in church. You never know what you're going to get. And last time, I spit a mint straight out in here. And you just never know what you're going to get. It's always fun in church. If you can't have fun in church, then I don't know where else you can have fun. So it's always good. So 2 Timothy, we're going to jump into this. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Is that good? Give the Word of God a hand. That is a good scripture. That is good. You may be seated. That is good. And all scripture, and we need to stand on this foundation as Christians, is that all scripture is God-breathed. It is important to have the belief that all scripture, everybody say all. All scripture, we're not taking and picking and choosing what we want to believe, but we are believing and standing on the Word of God that the Bible is God's Word, and it brings authority. Everybody say, my life. God's Word is bringing authority to my life. And today we're asking you one simple question, and are you going to let God's Word have authority in your life today? Are you going to give God's Word authority over your family and over your entire life so that when craziness happens in your life, you have somewhere to turn, that it is powerful and can bring you just the most amazing joy, but you know that it has authority over your life and it is God-breathed? So it is very important. The Bible says in Matthew 24, 35, that heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Everybody say, never pass away. That is awesome, that God's word will never pass away. Have you guys ever been through something in your life and you just feel like that you just need some comfort in your life? Anybody ever felt like that before? You just need something and you just turn to the word of God? You turn to the word of God. I remember when we were going through Gabe's open heart surgery, and he's the one who punched me in the face. When we were going through his open heart surgery, I've never dealt with any type of depression or anxiety or panic in my entire life until that time. And that was the craziest part of my life. And it just immediately hit me about 4 or 5 months before his birth. I was depressed. I was anxious. It was the worst time of my life. And I never had felt those feelings and emotions. I would wake up in the middle of the night in a panic and in sweat and just feel horrible. And I would, the only thing that could bring me comfort was turning to the word of the Lord. And I would get my Bible out or open my iPad or turn and find some scriptures that would bring me peace. And peace really would come over my life. And I had to make a habit of that, is just turning to the word of God. Everybody say, it's written. It is written in the Word of God, and our first fill-in-the-blank is, are you ready for this? All right, put it up there. It is historically accurate. The Bible is historically accurate. A lot of people say that the Bible is just a history book. It is a history book, but it is historically accurate. It is proven to be accurate historically, because there's eyewitness accounts. The Gospels are eyewitness accounts of Jesus' life. It's amazing. The Bible is historically accurate. The Bible says in Psalms 33:4, for the word of God is right and true. We're going to go to our next fill in the blank already. It is, put it up, scientifically accurate. Now, I'm not going to get into all of these scriptures here. I'm going to let you do a little bit of homework, but it is scientifically accurate. There are some mythological beliefs that the earth was held up. You ever seen the Atlas, the guy Atlas who has the globe on his shoulders? Like the Greek mythology is that, you know, Atlas is holding the globe up. But the Bible says that God sits above the circle of the earth, that he created everything in it. The stars cannot be counted. They used to think that the stars could be counted. But the Bible says that stars could not be counted. And the Bible also says in Leviticus that life is in the blood. You know, our first president died because they thought that that he had too much blood, and they did something called bloodletting. And they let some blood out, and they just let too much blood out of George Washington, and that's how he died. Crazy. But if they would have read the Bible, they would have known that life is in the blood. It's crazy. I'm just saying, he may still be around, you know. Old George, you just never know.